of class. The topic that I'm going to be talking to you all about today is the gender pay gap. And since, you know, two of the three of you are women, it is very relevant. Okay. First off, does the gap exist? Yes, it does. These statistics, they sort of range. I mean, different sources will say different things. It's off by about 3 cents, depending on what you look at. It's anywhere from about 79 cents that women earn for every dollar a man earns to 82 cents in one more recent estimate that I read. The thing about these estimates, though, is that they're not really comparing apples to apples. In economics, you would call this comparing aggregated data and essentially disaggregated data. So one of the things would be, like I said, the people that are being compared within these two categories is comparing all women and all men, and they don't necessarily work the same hours every week, etc. So the assertion that I would make is that there's not an issue with fair pay in our society, because fair pay and unequal pay, I would not say the two are the same thing. One thing within economics is that wages tend to approach marginal utility. So hopefully you can see this from back there. If you decide to do a supply and demand curve, this is your supply, this is your demand. You see the demand curve slows down, indicating that as prices get higher, your P's over on this axis, your Q's on this axis. As prices get higher, people are going to demand less of whatever it is, because people want less of things that are more expensive. It's not that they want less, but they'll purchase less of things that are more expensive. So you take this and you say, let's say that women have the exact same productivity of men overall. That's going to end up being an issue, because an employer could go out and make a killing hiring women that are of the same productivity as men. So same productivity as men, but pay them lower wages. And what they could do with this is they have lower costs. And with these lower costs, they could have lower prices. And essentially, everyone else who didn't take advantage of this would be driven out of business because they'd be underpriced. So it's a little bit of an oversimplification of things, but just for these purposes, it's more complicated than that. It's not just discrimination that's occurring within the markets. There's factors within our society and just within men and women overall that occur naturally that lead to differences in marginal utility. Because that's the main thing that you can take as a conclusion out of this, is that there must be some sort of a difference in marginal utility between men and women. Sorry, marginal utility, to define that for everybody, would just be, so the marginal utility of a worker would be the amount of output that you get out of a worker. So that'd be the marginal utility out of a worker. So what are some of the mechanisms for this? First off, there's differences between men and women in the workplace, and this can be reflected like statistically, or this can be shown statistically in the jobs that men and women choose. So first off, if you disaggregate the data a little bit, so instead of comparing all men and all women, you compare men that work a certain number of hours per week and women that work a certain number of hours per week. Because even if you compare full-time men and full-time women, you're still going to end up with men that work more hours per week, just the way that it works. Women want to do other things with their time. So you end up with, on average, men work more hours per week. And even in the 82 cents to every dollar that men earn comparison, you're still comparing women that work fewer hours per week to men that work more. So that's one thing that leads to it. Another thing is, and this would be in an article that Robert Higgs put out, is that this is a white, I believe it was a White House survey, and it had to do with, so what men and women seek in employment. This is statistically, this isn't overall, I mean, you know, a woman could really want to be a power CEO and want to make an insane amount of money, which is great. I mean, no one's saying whether that's right or wrong. But in general, men seek money and power, and women seek fulfillment, according to the survey. That's relative to each other. So you have more men seek those things, more women seek the other things. Additionally, men spend less time on domestic duties. I guess probably everybody can sort of guess this, but even when you have a man and a woman that are working roughly the same number of hours per week, the woman is still going to spend more time on domestic duties. And you may think, I don't know, if they're working the same number of hours per week, has this affected productivity? But the thing is, every hour that a woman spends on domestic duties is an hour that she isn't spending doing something else. So that could be, gaining more experience on the job. It could be doing online training. It could be something. So while women are essentially being stuck doing more domestic duties, men are out there potentially getting more productive. So that's one thing that sort of exacerbates the difference. Then another thing is men and women hold different jobs within fields. So that leads to a lot of differences in pay. So you may have roughly the same number of men and women that are going into medical fields these days, but you'll have women going into fewer surgery fields, and you'll have men, I guess, going into surgery fields, the more stressful stuff, the stuff that would be on call. Just statistically, I mean, there's different reasons for this. So in conclusion, what I would say is that unequal work and unequal pay are occurring together. So there would be examples of, you could definitely find examples of women being treated unfairly and being discriminated against, but that isn't going to account for the whole of the problem, because economics would tell you that a business that was being sexist is incorrect in doing so. Like, it couldn't happen statistically in a market in perfect competition. All right, additionally, according to a recent survey by Stevenson and Wolfers, women are less happy than ever, according to this survey. Who knows how they do these things? I don't necessarily buy into the whole deal with gauging people's happiness based on numbers, but that's what we have. And they came up with a correlation between women's work, so the amount of work that a woman does in the workplace, and happiness, and they find that they're inversely correlated. So essentially, as women strive to be more like men, they end up as unhappy as men have been the entire time, which is kind of unfortunate. Considering recent advances, I mean, you know, you'd think that hopefully with the society getting to be a little bit more equal in the way that men and women are treated just legally, women can have been able to sue for divorce the same as men can for many years, all these different things. Hopefully, men and women would be about as happy as each other, but that hasn't happened. Women have actually gotten less happy, and they're getting closer to men on how unhappy they are, which isn't the kind of equality that we would be striving for. So, reasons for this. All right, Golden did a study, this is over in India, on a couple different villages, and they essentially concluded that men and women view competition differently. So men like competition more than women do, essentially. And this can translate over into the workplace as within, all right, so within economics, you have what are called high effort and low effort jobs. Low effort would be paid on the hour, on salary. And then high effort would be paid on the procedure or on the sale or whatever. That'd be high effort, low effort. So think about it this way. Men are competitive. They choose more of these things where you're trying to see how many things you can get done in a certain amount of time. And women, they're more risk averse. You can think of it that way. So it can translate very well over to certain kinds of investment banking. But when it comes to sales or when it comes to being a surgeon, it doesn't translate quite as well for salary. And then if you look at, if you think about this, so as for an evolutionary mechanism for why this might be the case, why men might be higher risk takers than women. If you say that everybody's, let's say that everybody's living in a cave at the time, you have your men and your women, who's gonna go out and face a threat, right? If you have 10 men and 10 women, and you know, you send out your 10 women, and then one of them comes back, you send out your 10 men, and then one of them comes back, what's gonna work out better for the tribe? You only need one guy, you know, to get all the reproduction done, but each woman would be an extra incubating vessel for future offspring. So societies in which women would have been more aggressive and less risk averse, they would have died off pretty quickly just based on evolution. So that's sort of your evolutionary theoretical mechanism for why men would have ended up so aggressive. Okay. Now, solution for this politically. First off, women can out-earn men in certain fields, especially women that are recent college graduates now, because you have more women that are in college than men. In medical schools, it's roughly 50-50, and all these graduate schools would depend on grad school. But overall, there's more women than men in different, you know, universities. And as a result of this, women for about the first 5 to 10 years of their career, so early on, are starting to out-earn men. It's when children are born that you start to have problems because there's unequal child care, essentially. So that leads to women working less, that leads to lower salaries. So I don't necessarily look at egalitarianism as a good thing or a bad thing. you know, women being equal to men pay-wise and not equal, I think it depends on what priorities are. I'm of the opinion that legislation such as the Lilly-led Better Equal Pay Act back in 2009 are only going to hurt women, because essentially what it is, it's a wage and price control scheme. And what it's going to lead to is going to lead to the price of women's labor getting raised. It's going to lead to lower demand for it. Lower demand when it comes to labor is unemployment. So essentially, legislation like that is going to hurt women overall, even though it was intended to help them, and it'll lead to unintended consequences. Thank you.